Hey, everybody. It's Steve Presser. I'm the Director of Adult Discipleship here at Mount Zion Church, and I want to welcome you back. We're at the midpoint. We're at week four now in our series, Excruciating, Cries from the Cross. You know, a few years ago, my son was 5 years old, and as we talk today about a cry of despair, I'm sure you, just like me, can remember a time when you felt absolutely helpless, maybe even a little hopeless. A couple of years ago, my son experienced a traumatic brain tumor about 7 centimeters in the base of his brainstem. We were rushed to Johns Hopkins Hospital when we were told the news, and a couple of days later, he had to go into surgery. And I remember the look in my son's eyes. I still have pictures that bring us to tears when we look at him. But I remember when they put him on the stretcher to wheel him away for surgery, the looks in his eyes as if I had abandoned him. But the truth of the matter is, I had no choice but to hand him over to those doctors and those nurses for his own good. And it's a reminder to me a little bit of this story of Jesus. Because in this story of Jesus, we see this cry of despair, and we read about this cry in Matthew 27:46. So Jesus is on the cross, and I'll start a couple of verses earlier at verse 45. It says, "Now from the sixth hour, there was darkness over the land until about the ninth hour. And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, 'Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani?' That is, 'My God, why have you forsaken me?'" I can understand that feeling of Jesus. I can understand that feeling, the perception of that feeling, that God would somehow abandon us. Maybe you've asked yourself that question too. You may even ask yourself, why would Jesus ask God why he's forsaking him when he knew all along his own purpose? That's a really good question. And we're going to dive into it a little bit here today. One of the things I'll point to you first is, let's go again to Isaiah 53. Isaiah 53 is again this suffering servant passage. And in Isaiah 53:4-6, we read, "Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God and afflicted. He was wounded for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace, and with his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all." So we need to know first what's taking place on this cross as Jesus is hanging there. Well, one of the things he's doing is he is bearing the sin. He is bearing our sin and its penalty on the cross, right? It says in 1 Peter 2:24 that he himself bore our sins in his body on the tree. In 2 Corinthians 5:21, God made him who had no sin to be sin for us. And as we just read in Isaiah 53, the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. The other thing taking place here is that the innocent is suffered or is suffering for the guilty, right? So in 1 Peter 3:18, we read that, "For Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but being made alive in the spirit." And then again in Romans 5:18-19, "Therefore, as one trespass led to condemnation for all men," so we're going back to Adam again, "just as one trespass led to condemnation for all men, so one act of righteousness leads to justification and life for all men. For as by the one man's disobedience, many were made sinners, so by one man's obedience, the many will be made righteous." So Jesus is doing on the cross our atoning work. He is our substitute in these moments, and that he is taking on in the body the weight of the sin of the world. Now, I read this one book about some of the different sayings of Jesus, and there was a really interesting comment made. And this one author, he said that in the moments of Jesus crying out, my God, why have you forsaken me? It's really a picture of hell. And the way that he described this is, he says, the phrase is not a phrase of theological questioning, right? So a lot of us like to kind of sit on this for a bit and we say, well, did God turn his face away or did God abandon Jesus? And this author says he doesn't believe that's the case. And he has a couple of reasons for that, most of which I would agree with. And we'll get to that in a moment. But he's in the midst of great agony. And if you and I have ever been in situations of great agony, you just can't help but feel abandoned. I shared that story with my son, and we were feeling that in those moments. And at the same time, there is this great tension of faith, right? I was reading some books at that time, and I could just feel it. I could feel the tension of faith. I could feel the loneliness and the dark clouds that hovered over that entire situation and circumstance, which was successfully resolved, by the way. My son's very very happy and healthy today as a result of those surgeries. But think about Jesus here for a minute. The agony of Jesus first started in the garden. He asked the Father if it's possible to take this cup away from him, right? But he knew that wasn't necessarily going to be the case. And so they go out to the Garden of Gethsemane, and I think this is a really interesting point. The word Gethsemane actually means olive press. So if you can imagine an olive press, the lifeblood of an olive is squeezed out drop by drop. What happened at the garden? In Jesus' own agony, he's beginning to sweat droplets of blood and mixed in with his sweat and his tears. And it was here in the garden that he began to fill the cup, so to speak, that was requested to be taken of him by who? By his Father in heaven. So at the cross then, the cup would be filled. But getting back to the picture of hell, there's a few things that we see in the whole scene at the cross. Number one, Jesus is in conscious suffering, right? And we see that as a picture of hell as well. Jesus was also in blackened darkness. For 3 hours, he hung on the cross in what looks like daylight hours. Mark tells us he was on the cross by 9 a.m. But here in this passage, we're saying that about the 9th hour, from the 6th hour, there was darkness until about the 9th hour. So that'd be from noon to about 3. That darkness was hovering over the earth. And so what is hell if not for outer darkness, right? To be separated from God. He's also in these moments, he's being hurled insults at and all this. He's surrounded by demonic powers. He's also bearing the sin that was due to us on himself, right? So he's bearing sin. He is under judgment. And he is seemingly separated from the love of God. There's no ability to be rescued in these moments, right? So there's a lot of discussions as to whether hell is real, and sadly, many churches are even teaching that hell is not a reality. And if hell is not real, then why did Jesus have to go through it? Simply put, why did Jesus have to go through it? Why the cross? Why the separation? Why the wrath of God poured out on him if hell is not a reality? The scripture says he will save us from our sin. Well, what's the punishment of sin? The punishment of sin is the reality of hell. Another thing to point out in this whole scene, this cry of despair, is that it's according to the plan and fulfillment of the scriptures, right? The wrath of God poured out on Jesus and the agony of Jesus in these moments is all according to plan. And the phrase really is kind of the beginning of the script. So I want to encourage you to turn to Psalm 22. And at the end of this video, give Psalm 22 a very thorough reading because it really is the script of Jesus and the cross. I'll give you a few highlights here and you can see them match up as you read here in a few moments. But in verse 1, he actually starts, my God, why have you forsaken me? In verse 2, it says day and night, right? So day and night. Well, he was on the cross both during the day as well as the night. He was also in Gethsemane at night until, and of course, had a sleepless night. and then was, of course, crucified during the day. In verse 6 to 8, there's an exact script of those who mocked him. In verse 14 of Psalm 22, it says that he would be poured out like water, his bones out of joint, but not yet broken. In verse 15, it says that he had no strength and his tongue dried up. We'll have more on that next week. In verse 16 to 18, they have pierced my hands and feet. My bones are on display. We're going to talk more about this next week too, about the scourging of Jesus and just how gruesome and how graphic that must have been. There's one author that talked about just the brutality of scourging, especially with the cat of nine tails. And he said that the flesh of the body would look like ribbons hanging off the bones. So when he says here that my bones are on display, you can imagine the scourging of Jesus. They stare at me. They divide and cast lots for my garments. And then in verse 22 and 23, it says, I will tell of your name, and many will stand in awe of him. What did he say to John and his own mother? He said, behold your son, right? Behold. And then in verse 30 to 31, it's probably a script that gets forgotten about. It says, and they shall tell to generations to come that he has done it. We'll talk more in a couple of weeks that it is finished, right? So all of Psalm 22 speaks to this prophetic script of Jesus and the cross. Now, in his despair in those moments, I think, Jesus recognizes that the Father's love is beyond reach, right? He has to endure the cross. He has to endure the cross. So Jesus is experiencing the separation from God that sinners deserved. The sense of being forsaken was not so much that God looked away from Jesus, but rather that from his looking at him in wrath and in judgment as a condemned sinner, right? I mean, look at what Jesus said in John 10, verse 17. The Father did not cease to love Jesus. How can that happen? How can you divide the unity of the Trinitarian God? You just can't do that, I believe. The Father did not cease to love Jesus. In fact, Jesus said, the reason my Father loves me is that I lay down my life, John 10, 17. So how could the Father cease to love Jesus while he's in the act of doing the very thing that he was instructed to go forth and do? The Father did not stop loving the Son in these hours of darkness, but wrath is being poured out on the Son as he takes on the sin of the world and the weight of sinners. So did the Father turn his face away? I would suggest no. The feelings of being alone and forsaken are probably there, but the actuality is very, very different. If I could go back to my son and my story with him earlier, I can imagine, I told you, I remember the look in his eyes as they wheeled him away from his waiting room into the operating room. And I could see in his eyes the fear and just overcome with emotion. And I think if he could say it, he would say, why are you letting this happen to me? But me as a father, I have no choice but to let him go through with this surgery, to be pulled away from my own reach, as it were, right? So why is this so important? Well, for one, it's biblical accuracy. When we teach something that isn't in the scripture, we further diminish the authority of the scriptures. Number two, we are prone to feeling and therefore believing that God has somehow abandoned us, right? A lot of people feel that way. And if God can abandon his own son, how much more then is the possibility that God would abandon us? But the truth of the scriptures, it teaches the opposite, that there is design in our sufferings, yes, but that God has never left us, will never leave us, he will never forsake us, and that there, of course, sometimes is design in suffering. Let me go back to Psalm 22, because if everything that I have said has any weight at all, just read what the scripture itself says. I told you how Psalm 22 is kind of a script for the sufferings of Jesus and all that he would endure. But in Psalm 22, I believe it is at verse 24. If I can turn there quickly. In Psalm 22, verse 24, this is what it says. For he has not despised or abhorred the affliction of the afflicted. The affliction of the afflicted. Well, that'd be Jesus. He has not despised or abhorred it. And he has not hidden his face from him. But what? But has heard when he cried to him, a cry of despair. Jesus is crying out in despair in these moments. And while the reach of the Father is beyond him, the reality is God never turned his face from Jesus. And he will never turn his face from you, right? He will never leave you, abandon you, or forsake you. And in this cry of despair, I think we see the reality versus the perception. And that's one of the questions I have for you in the description below as you look through the notes for the week is, what is the reality versus the perception, right? Because the reality is the Father never turned his face away from Jesus. The Father loves Jesus. The Father was pleased that Jesus would go through what he went through for us. But I can definitely understand the perception. My God, why have you forsaken me? And as Jesus was one who lived by every word of God, we'll talk more about this in the coming couple of weeks, but perhaps this was a moment where Jesus was reciting the entirety of the psalm. And it just so happens that our gospel writers were able to capture under the weighted breath of Jesus these very, very words. As he's living out the psalms, as he's living out the very word of God, what an incredible thought that he would live out the word of God even until his last breath. So God has never left you, will never leave you. He will never abandon or forsake you. And I hope that in hearing these cries of despairs, you too may, in your prayers, as you go before God, consider the difference between what you may perceive to be a feeling versus the reality of the scriptures. Rest on his promises and rest on the truth of his word. God bless you and your families. Take care.